How's it? My name is Trenton Birch. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Chiba Africa, which is a health, wellness, and cannabis education company. So I come from the music industry, have been a promoter, a record label owner, an artist. I still am an active artist. I've been in education for almost 12 years now in creative media education. So I came from the music industry into music and creative education.
So my name is Linda Sibodo, and I'm one of the co-founders of Chiba Africa. And basically my background is around the film industry. I worked about 20 years with my own production company. And through that, I basically learned about networking and also relationship management and so on. And also, yeah, I started like 3 startups, and this would be like my 4th one now. So yeah.
Tell us why did you choose the Vol Triangle?
I think the Vol Triangle chose us, to be honest. We decided to come to the Vol Triangle because the facility became available. It's an ex-mining training facility, so to find a space like this closer to the city is near impossible. We're right on the Vol River. There's a lot of sort of regeneration of, you know, mine dumps that can be done through hemp in this area, and there seems to be, because of the Vol's industrial history, bringing on, you know, testing labs and extraction facilities, I think there's a huge potential for certain sectors of the Vol industry to transform and bring cannabis online. We're already in discussion with a brick making company in the area who want to start making hempcrete bricks. So this has a manufacturing history and is a manufacturing hub. And we feel that the cannabis industry, as much as there's all the flashy stuff that you see, ultimately it's still an industry, and it needs industry support and industry mechanics and factories. So we also wanted to be outside of the city, because in the city there's all kinds of distractions. When you come out here, you're in a space where there's wild monkeys, you're in nature, you're in the bush. So when you come to study here, there's no distraction. So being away from the city, we thought was a really good, powerful thing. And the people in the Vol have just been so warm and open and really encouraging. So it's been a great sort of place and space to be.
So, you know, from a spiritual perspective, from a health and wellness perspective, you know, from a purely health perspective, I think there's tremendous potential. But it needs a lot of people involved, a lot of training, and we need to educate ourselves on cannabis. We've been disallowed and disinformed for 50, 60 years, so we're having to undo, we're having to unlearn to relearn. So it's quite a complicated process. So we open on April 1st, and that's not a joke. It just happens to be the day that is the first week of the April month. We have our first intake starting then. We already have students signed up for it. We have been running for the last 8 months as an online academy, where we do blended learning courses. You can either do self-study online, or you can join a blended learning model where you do Zoom classes. So we have those models as well. And we have courses for all kinds of people in the industry, from growing to sort of medicinal cannabis. And we're constantly developing new courses and new content to support the industry as it grows.
This is a very exciting part of the facility, because this is where we grow cannabis. We're not growing cannabis yet. You can see we've just prepped it and put it up. So this is where our students will spend hours every single day learning how to grow cannabis, learning how to clone, learning about nutrients, genetics. This course is also very much about getting hands-on. So, you know, you need to learn to grow, and you need to be in a space like this. So we put this tunnel up as our first tunnel. Hopefully as we grow, we'll build multiple tunnels and put them onto the property. But, you know, we've invested in a proper professional tunnel to make sure that our students are getting the best possible access to the best possible facilities from the minute they arrive. So part of our grow curriculum is obviously learning to grow cannabis. But what's super important to us is people also learning to grow food. Food security is becoming a really big topic at the moment, and we need to empower people to be able to grow their own food. So if you can't grow a companion plant, which is used to complement cannabis growing in terms of pest management, or a tomato, you actually won't graduate from the course. So we want to teach people to grow their own food. Cannabis, we also believe, is a food and can be used in many, many ways in food. So why not be able to grow food like lettuce and tomatoes when you learn to grow cannabis? So this space will be to facilitate that as well.
Can you perhaps just give us a list of all the courses available here and what?
Oh, I have to remember them all. I mean, we have contact courses and we have online courses. So we have medical professional courses. We have a medical course which is available for CPD points, which the medical professionals need to do to keep their license. So that's been accredited through the HSPCA, the Healthcare Practitioners Association. We have courses on growing for small scale, whether you want to grow at home. We also have commercial grow courses, so 3-day immersive, deeply intense courses on how to scale up. It's one thing to grow 10 plants at home, it's a whole other thing to grow 2,000 plants. So we have commercial courses, and we're busy developing a whole lot of others. We have a bud tender course designed for dispensaries and designed for people working in the cannabis clubs. I can't remember every single course, but it's growing by the day.
I saw something on the news the other day about the police did some sort of dacha bust. But in the same, I mean, what is the legalities? I mean, is it legal? I mean, at this stage, what, or is it?
So the legal question is a bit of a minefield, and I'm not a lawyer, so I don't claim to be an expert on the legalities. But essentially, at the moment, the private purposes bill in September 18 that went through the Constitutional Court allows an individual to grow cannabis at home and to consume cannabis, but not to trade, not to sell. And there are limitations around that, although there is a new bill out at the moment that's been tabled, which is a cannabis industry we have totally rejected. It's uninformed and doesn't work in our environment. You can trade CBD within certain limitations in terms of the amount of CBD in a particular package or the dosing. We also do not agree with those particular protocols that have been put in place by SAHPRA because they're outdated, they do not follow international trends, and we feel that they've been put in place to slow the industry down while the pharmaceutical industries get in on the game. And so there are things that need to be sorted in that space. From a regulatory perspective, in terms of growing, you can get a grow license, but at the moment you need an offtake agreement internationally. So there is an opportunity to grow and export, but you need GMP facilities, it's highly expensive, the barriers to entry are very high. We don't have a local trade industry here as yet, apart from CBD. And until we get that, things are going to take a lot longer to grow.
In terms of intake, how many students, I don't know if I've asked this already, but like how many students do you have enrolled at
So it's changing every day. Our targets that we've set for ourselves are modest. We're not expecting 100 students on campus for the first intake. I'm not sure what we're on at the moment, but we're expecting at least sort of 20 to 40 students for our first intake. As it gains momentum, as we gain trust, as people can see the campus, seeing is believing, it's all one thing to say. But when people get here, they get it. It's a beautiful space. There are wild monkeys here. You really feel like you're in the African bushveld. So we're trying to create a space that has no distractions. So ultimately, you know, we are not over ambitious about the numbers in the beginning. We need to earn our school fees and we need to build our credibility. But in time, we have accommodation for 190 students on campus. And we're very confident in the next 2-3 years, we'll have sort of 300-400 students on this campus.
Just tell me about the scholarship initiative.
Sure. So the Dacha couple have been activists in the forefront of, you know, basically legislation around cannabis and basically opening up the plant for everybody else to beneficiate from it. So we have a relationship with the Dacha couple, and one of them who was murdered last year was Julius Stubbs, and we thought in commemorating his memory, we would then set up this scholarship in his name. And we're hoping to, you know, currently it's offered to a learner every time we have an intake, but we are opening up to, you know, to industry to also offer up their assistance, whether it be transport, food, or so on. So we are aiming to grow that to more people, and yeah, that's really what it's about. Yeah.
In terms of the facilities here, can you just run me through? Okay, so you've got this lecture hall. Give me sort of a short.
So one of the beauties of this campus is that the facilities are incredible. It used to be a mining training facility, so there was a lot of expense put into the infrastructure. So we have accommodation for 190 students, and that ranges from dormitories to actually an on-site 3-star hotel on the campus. Swimming pools, squash courts, we have a grow tunnel which we have built, we have a laboratory which is coming online, it's a partnership with Cure Labs. There's a big auditorium which you can see behind me, and another 6 lecture rooms. So we have ample space to grow into, and the grounds are very big as well, so in the long term, we have potential to do, you know, events here and festivals and really make it into this cannabis hub. There are also a number of houses on the property, so we're moving into a few of those. So the aim is to really expand and bring extraction equipment in and really make it a full spectrum, full supply chain space.
In terms of lecturers that you've got signed up, can you run me through a list of people?
So we have some incredible people who are going to be lecturing at the campus. They have a lot of experience in the industry. We've also taken people from outside the industry. So when we do supply chain management, we cover supply chain management as a discipline, and then we bring cannabis into that matrix. If we're doing permaculture, we bring someone in who's an expert on permaculture. So the lectures are very varied. You know, the good thing about the industry is, you know, people love to teach. So we've had no issues finding people to teach. But you know, it's also they're not a dime a dozen, because a lot of people, there are not a lot of highly experienced people in this industry. Trying to find someone to teach extraction, for example, you have to dig quite deep through the network to find people. But we do have some incredible people on board.
In South Africa and in Africa, you know, Prohibition, the United Nations recently in December actually deschedulized cannabis. So for a long time, there hasn't been any official space where people can actually learn about cannabis and also have content that actually speaks to that. And so we have realized the first African Cannabis Academy in Africa. And essentially, that's what that is.